Good morning, it's Zach with Tevis Architects in Lenexa. I'm out here right outside of Lake Quivira. Today is March 1st, 2016, and it's a big day for our first net zero home. As you can see in the background here, we've got our concrete trucks and our pumper is in, and we've started pouring concrete in our footings for our foundation walls. So I'm gonna jump up around the side and see if I can get a little bit better view so you can see what's going on, try to stay out of these guys' way, and we'll talk about it.
Okay, so here you can see the big concrete pumper that they brought in. Basically, any time we have a site that has any amount of grade, and this one definitely does, a pumper is just an invaluable asset. It's the most important tool to have to get your concrete in. So it's regular concrete. They thin the mix a little bit just to get it to flow a little bit better. Of course, anytime you thin it, you're sacrificing some strength with that. So it's wet enough to pump and dry enough to be strong. But as you can see, the truck's emptied there into that hopper.
Let me try to zoom in so you can see that. There you go. So there's a hopper on the back of the pumper truck, and concrete emptied into the hopper, and then it gets pumped up. And then just like a crane arm, that white tube on the outside, that's where our concrete's coming. We're gonna come down, and we got guys up on site that are directing the spout on the end to fill all of our forms.
All right, so we're up here on top now. You can see you got the guys walking along there at the top of the form, just directing that into that pumper. Fill all of our forms with concrete, and they usually start at one corner or one spot and kind of work their way around to evenly fill that.
So from up here on top, you can really see how far we're taking everything. So our pumper's down there, we're coming all the way up
over our trees that we're trying to save. And we're coming down on this end.
I also want to show you this whole arm and the truck and everything that's remote down there. It's controlled remotely right up here. Gives the operator on site the best view, because a lot of times you're coming pretty far from where the truck is to where you're pouring. They've got the little remote there that you can steer the boom up overhead and move it from left to right or further out. Pretty cool.
You can see after we get the forms all the way to the top, this guy's coming along and just kind of knocking that down, leveling it off so it's nice and flat and smooth. And once this concrete sets up a little bit,
They'll come back and they'll drop some J-bolts down in there, some anchor bolts to hold our top of our wall up on top of there. There'll be a sill plate that'll go down and we'll bolt all the sills through those J-bolts and lock that in. As you can see, they're trying to keep a continuous pour all the way around on the basement wall and the foundation wall. Once they get all of the basement poured, then they'll come back and they'll finish out the porch and probably the garage too. So I came down here to the end of the house, just a little bit quieter. I was worried about some of the noise in the background. I also wanted to talk a little bit about some of your different foundation options. We're doing a poured foundation here, which means we bring in these removable forms here. You can see the stacks on the inside, the steel racks. After this concrete is cured, they will come back and they'll pull all these forms off. They're coated down with a release agent before we pour. To make sure that they don't stick to the walls. This is one of the most economical ways of doing a foundation wall. Of course, another option is CMU block. There's a couple drawbacks to CMU. One is that you've got a heck of a lot of joints there. And as far as labor goes, it's more labor intensive because you have to have masons come out on site and actually lay them all up. And even if you you completely fill them, you're still bringing a concrete truck out. One thing we very closely consider using for this foundation is ICM or ICF, insulated concrete forms, or insulated concrete masonry. For us and for the size and scope of this project, it was cost prohibitive. But basically an ICF is a styrofoam form that stays in place. Now they pour them the same way that we're showing here, but rather than having removable forms on the outside, you have kind of styrofoam Lego bricks. But insulating your foundation walls is very important, especially if it's going to be finished living space, which in our case it is. And so in the weeks ahead, as we kind of move forward and we track our progress through here, you'll see one of the things that we're doing is we're adding insulation to the outside of these foundation walls. It's usually a step that's skipped. It's something that we are doing because of our net zero intent with this home. And for us, we're trying to keep this an affordable home for someone to get into an extremely energy efficient option. The ICF just wasn't doable. Now we may see, you know, maybe our phase two house, our phase three house, it'll be more viable. The numbers just didn't pan out on this one, but that doesn't mean we're not insulating. We absolutely are. It'll just be EPS foam that we're going to do on the outside of the wall before we backfill. I also wanted to talk about down here on the end wall of the house. You'll see we have this little bump. This is what's referred to as a dead man. Why is it a dead man? Well, a dead man is there to stabilize this long wall along our basement foundation and to keep it from tipping over. So typically on a concrete wall, especially one this long, you're going to have some lateral movement, some left and right. As we start to backfill, you'll have all the soil pressure. As the dirt gets wet, you're going to have hydrostatic pressure, and all those forces on the outside of that wall want to cave it in. And when you do a really, really long run, typically anything over 30 feet, it needs some lateral support in there. Now, most of the time we don't want those sticking into the inside of the house, so we move them to the outside of the wall. it's there to support that concrete wall. As we backfill, you know, it's not ever going to be seen. But again, it's just part of doing a really strong, well-built foundation. And this is our front wall of the house. As you can see along here, no dead men. Why do we not have any dead men? Well, we've got enough bumps and corners and kickouts in the walls themselves that no one wall is more than 30 feet. So we don't really need any of the additional support along here. The wall itself is doing what the dead man would do.
So it's now about 9 o'clock in the morning, and I think they started pouring pretty much right at about 8:30. So you can see one of the big advantages to using the pumper is just how quick everything goes. They started at the front corner of the house. We're already now about halfway around the foundation walls. So I'm guessing that, you know, this whole foundation is probably going to take maybe about 2 hours. Whereas without the pumper, they'd be trying to get trucks up our huge hill, which may not have worked at all. And then trying to get enough angle on the chutes to get everything lined up, and it just isn't worth it. Part of our effort up here has been all along, and I talked about this in the last video, to preserve some of these trees, some of the natural environment around here. We want this house to look like it's been here a while, not like it's brand new construction. And in order to do that and get trucks up here, we'd have had basically a road all the way around this house, enough space to get a concrete truck up, plus our over excavation on our foundations. So the pumper really, really gives us a lot more freedom and a lot more flexibility. It just makes everything go quicker. They aren't cheap. You know, you try to make its use minimum if possible. But for what we're doing up here, I think almost every pour that we have, we will have the pumper, just because it allows us to work so much better.
So I mentioned earlier that this is a continuous pour. Basically, once the concrete starts flowing, they don't want to have to stop anywhere. And this is where it comes down to having a really good operator, really good guy on the stick. It's got good experience and knows what he's doing. If we look here, this corner is where they started their pour. And so we've gone continuous all the way around to that far corner. There's the front door of our house. And we've come along this wall of the garage. And they will continue moving around the loop back on the far side, the front wall of the garage. And they'll come back. They'll go around the perimeter of the front porch, and then they're back almost to where they started, so that they don't have to pick up and move that machine very far to pick up the rest of the wall and work their way around this perimeter. And they will end up right back there.
So it just speaks to hiring the right people to do the right parts of the job. We're lucky to have the foundation guys we do. They're very, very busy, and they manage to work us into their schedule. And so even here on the first day of March, in this chilly weather out here, we've got a good group of guys that's trying to get our footings in before spring.
So I came over to the back side of the house here. I wanted to show these shorter walls here. We've got enough changes back and forth, and we got corners to provide that lateral support. And then we come to our kitchen wall here, and we've got a really long wall. So we've got a dead man in there. The wall here along the garage is long enough that it would also need support. But rather than doing a dead man, we have this back foundation wall, and we have on the opposite side the front wall for the garage. So those two walls are providing enough lateral support that we don't need a dead man inside this wall, which is good because that's where our stairs are coming down.
Yeah.
So I want to talk a little bit more about this garage slab. In the last video, I talked about the pier foundations and how we're going to support that slab in here. On this front wall here, you could see something that's pretty important. These are the blockouts for the garage doors. So a lot of times, especially today, kind of spec houses, build-a-grade construction, when it comes to doing a garage slab, it's just a trench footing. They literally just dig a trench in the ground and fill it with concrete. There's not a lot of force, or, you know, usually there's only one level that's gonna be setting on it. And they say, well, it's a garage, so it's not that important. But we're actually doing a full 4-foot foundation wall along here, which gives us much better support for that slab. So drop down here. You can see we've got these blockouts in. Because our walls are going to come up higher than our garage slab will be, we've got to put the blockouts in the slab to make sure that we've got room to get the doors in. The blockouts are a little bit oversized for the door. That way we can bring our timber all the way down. And that'll be rough finish, but that's why that part of the floor doesn't come all the way up to the top of the foundation wall. We're also, we've tried to make an effort in laying out and designing that we don't need any foundation straps into the footings. It tends to get real expensive, and a lot of builder grade garages are kind of, you know, the minimum size. This is a nice big garage. We're able to get 3 full size vehicles in. We've gone with a full 16-foot door and a full 10-foot door. And we've tried to leave enough space that when you pull your car in, you can still open your doors and get out. And so that's all those little things just go into making the house better designed and more functional. So I talked earlier about the J-bolts that will go in. That's what he's doing right now. He just kind of walks along the perimeter. I think we're going every 2 feet or so. And he works those J-bolts down into that wet concrete. The anchor bolts on the corner are really important because those walls right there at the perimeter of the garage door are going to carry the weight of the header that goes across the garage door. It also provides all of the support for shear in there, which is the twisting of the building. So they'll double anchor on this corner foundation walls. One out of the corner and then one in a little bit further there. That's to provide all the support to use that wall as a braced wall panel to keep it from twisting. You can see the notch in there, the block out now for those garage doors. They got a little jig set up with their forms that they can scrape the bottom of that to make sure it's at the right elevation down. And anything that's over 4 on that, they just scoop out. Now, when we pour our garage slab, it will come back over the top of that wall to help support that slab when it hits the garage there. So here you can see, just like we thought, they finished up that whole porch pour. That goes real quick because it's just a 4-foot wall around there. And they picked up back on our other side of our front windows there. And they'll go ahead and start pumping at that point and work their way all the way around that back perimeter.
How much you got? I don't know. You know how much
you have on?
Good.
How are you doing?
I'm doing fine.
Excited to see something going in finally.
You see my? Well, I've been watching all morning. You see our cameras? We've got one little camera over here on the tree, and then there's another one up here on this tree over here. And we're not doing quality control there, but at least we can see what kind of activity is going on in the job.
See, now's when you need your drone out here.
It's a little windy for the drone, but we could do that. Well, I think we'll do that. I think we'll fly over it a little bit, you know.
Maybe when we get to framing, we can do some drone shots.
It'd be kind of cool right now because you could fly over the concrete pumper and see how they're staged up there. They got two trucks backed up there right now.
Yeah.
I followed one in. So I'm driving down the road and I'm thinking, that's probably my concrete truck right in front of me. And he was slow, but I didn't honk at him.
Don't piss him off.
not today. Good. Well, there's our front porch. There's if I was ever going to try to escape from some type of a natural disaster, I'd cut a hole in that wall and hide in that cavity.
Yeah,
right there.
I think it'd work. Starting to put the pumper truck away. It's been right at an hour since we started pouring, and they're already done. Mark the Brabander Foundation Company and their crew, just really, really talented guys. There you can see the back end of the pumper truck. So this is the chute. This is where the trucks dump into. Got an agitator down in there that keeps everything mixing, keeps it loose. And it basically shoots right out the bottom of there. And it forces it up the tube. And that tube runs continuous all the way over to our arm and then right up the boom. So they're gonna start cleaning this out now. He may actually be right off to another pour today. They've mostly got our pumper truck cleaned out. He's coming out here now. He's going to start putting the boom away. We got our pumper truck mostly cleaned out. You can see starting to fold up the arms now.